There's a couple of, you know, well, there's, in fairness, there's a ton of questions, but I think there's a couple of questions that I find most challenging, especially as a clinician. I think one of those is, when is the right time to start cytoreductive treatment? You know, there are treatment algorithms that exist for adult patients. I don't think we have any data that says those are appropriate to use in very young children. And I often struggle with what is the right time to start a cytoreductive medication in a child. And there are times where I meet children for consultation from other centers who are already on a cytoreductive drug, and I'm not necessarily sure I would have started them for the same reason. You know, and I've talked to colleagues about this, the question of when is the right time. So is it based on symptoms? Is it only when a child has a blood clot or a severe bleeding event? Is it in children who have acquired VW and maybe can't participate in sports or are having their quality of life affected because they're at risk of bleeding? Or is there some kind of magic blood count number? You know, people always ask me, is there a platelet count number that you would start treating at? And the answer is no. I mean, we have no idea what that is. And I think we have good data in adults that platelet count doesn't correlate with thrombotic events. Obviously, if you have a very high platelet count and you have acquired von Willebrand and you're at risk of bleeding, that may be a good time to start, but there's not a magic platelet number. And I've seen kids with fairly high platelet counts walk around with no symptoms and do very well. And then I've seen kids with lower platelet counts have blood clots. So I think timing of when to start cytoreduction is really a big question. I think part of that is related to the treatments themselves and, you know, the question of what treatments are appropriate for young patients. I think right now in pediatrics, we use hydroxyurea and sometimes interferon. Hydroxyurea is something in pediatrics we've used for many, many years for sickle cell disease. That is a very different disease. So I don't think it's necessarily appropriate that we extrapolate our experience from sickle cell to MPNs, but I think that's what happens. And there's some data that more kids get hydroxyurea than other treatments, and we don't know if that's right. So looking at interferon more, seeing if that's more appropriate for children, if it's well tolerated, thinking about new drugs coming out, are there other drugs that might have better side effect profiles for young patients, especially when thinking about leukemic transformation and fertility questions. But we don't really know. So I think timing of cytoreduction and what medications to use are really two big questions. I think another question I struggle with as a pediatrician is the iron deficiency in a number of the PV patients, because we know iron deficiency can have its own consequences and side effects. And in a perfect world, we don't leave children iron deficient. We usually replete iron in those children. But when you have polycythemia vera, if we give you iron, often it will drive up your counts and make you need more phlebotomy or have more symptoms, and sort of a vicious cycle. So thinking about the iron deficiency in young patients, and is that different than how it affects older patients, is something I think is really interesting and that we really haven't started looking at in young kids. And then I think one big question is sort of what drives these diseases. Again, I think the systematic review pointed out there were a lot of triple negative patients. I don't know if all of those patients truly had MPNs, but certainly there are a number of kids who are triple negative. We see that in our own cohort at Cornell. So, you know, wondering what pathways are involved in driving disease in those patients, what mutations might be driving disease, are there other forms of MPNs, you know, are they truly classical MPNs, are they some kind of familial disorders, are they something different? I think we just don't know. So I think, you know, we're sort of just getting past the tip of the iceberg with these things, and I think there's a lot of questions we don't have the answers to.